What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about a subject that's not something that a lot of people talk about, which is the, you know, the devil in the detail, right? What makes us a great data scientist versus the knower of all the tools and algorithms. And that transition, right, between knower of all tools and algorithms versus being a great data scientist, what does it take? And, you know, I'll show you some of the things that I have learned over a period of time. And I put them all together as what I call the art of data mining. And don't think of this as one big talk. It's like, you know, seven small talks. So, you know, don't look for a coherent theme. I'm going to talk about many, many different kinds of things that we have learned. And hopefully some of the things will be useful to you in what you're doing, right? All right, So if I had to summarize what I'm trying to do is basically I'm you know, sort of making this a reality, which is in theory and practice are the same, but in practice they are not, right? In practice, things are different, so we're going to see how things are in practice when we apply all the stuff that people do. All right, so we all are here because we believe that, you know, we are drowning in data, and we saw a lot of data of different kinds today. We saw genomics data, but you can imagine, right, people coming from different verticals. You have data in all these verticals. So we are really drowning in information and starving for knowledge. And the goal is now to extract more meaning and insight into this, take better decisions and all that. So let's look at the life of data, right? So the first thing we all do is clean, right? It's a never-ending process. Then we do basic things like we summarize, we report. Then we do more interesting things, right? The dawn of the database system, the indexing, the searching, the internet. And this is where we are. We are very efficient at that. And the next stage is we understand what the hell the data is, right? Can we understand the data the way we do, as humans would, right? Can machines understand the data, visualize it? Then we analyze and build models, and then we generalize and make predictions. And once we have made predictions, then we make decisions out of those predictions, right? So really, what we are doing is we are making decisions out of data. We are not just storing it. We are not just analyzing it. We are not just writing our MapReduce jobs on it. We are, at the end of the day, we are making decisions from it. So let's look at some of the stages, right? So we generate some insights, we create some features, we build some models on those features, we make some predictions, and then using those predictions and some business objectives, we make some decisions. And based on the decisions, we get some feedback, which we add to the data, and then the cycle goes on and on, right? So you can apply this model in all of your domains. And obviously, the kinds of features you create and the kinds of business objectives you have, you're going to get different kinds of decisions and all that. So we won't go into that. But let me ask a question first. What do you think makes us intelligent? Pardon? Applying what we know, okay. Identifying patterns. Huh? Predicting things. Great. Right? So we all agree that there is a clear definition of what makes us intelligent, right? Dogs are less intelligent, plants are even less intelligent, and maybe, you know, future humans will be more intelligent. So what makes us intelligent? So let me tell you in one slide what makes us intelligent. This is just part of the definition. So let's see how many of you can recognize the letter on that. They're all the same letter, right? What letter is that? A, right? Have any one of you seen any of these A's before? No, right? And still we do this. And that's a transition between a database and a intelligent system, right? So we learn from that. And this is one of the important qualities of data mining, which is generalization, the ability to predict and assign a label to a new observation. So these are all new observations based on the model. So we have a model of A, we have a model of B, we have a model of a BMW car, we have a model of our grandmother. So we can, you know, recognize all those things based on that, and that's what makes us intelligent, right? So let's look at how do we make machines intelligent. So we know humans are intelligent, most of them, right? And then, so how do we make machines intelligent now? So there's a whole process, there is an art, and there is a science to it, right? So you know, we collect data. So you have sensors all over the world of different kinds, right? Remote sensing, genomic sensors, all kinds of sensors. A click is also a sensor. Then we also collect the ground truth, which is the what the value you should predict. So if you are predicting, you know, if you are measuring some kind of thing on the ground, somebody has to go to that place and actually see what is on the ground, and that will be what the output is. Then we build, you know, engineer features, and then we train our model, we pick a model type, and then we evaluate the model, and then we deploy the model. Once we deploy the model, we get predictions on the unseen data, right? So we all understand that part. And there is some art, there is some science, and then there is some engineering in all this, right? Engineering is the scale and all that. Art is what we're going to talk about. And there's a lot of science in terms of modeling techniques and all that, right? So now we'll start with the short, you know, think of these as flash talks, okay? So let's start with some of the things that we can do better to improve our model. So I'm going to give these titles to each of these short talks. So this one is called Tame the Distribution Chaos, okay? So let's look at, so what I did this morning was I went to the Kaggle and I downloaded this data from Higgs boson, and I just looked at the distributions of those features, right? So here are four distributions of, there are 30 dimensions in this data, and look at the distributions. If I want to show you some more, these are distributions. This is what I call a distribution chaos, that all your features have a very different character to it, right? Now imagine if you want to, what will happen if this is the case, right? If none of the distributions are kind of similar, what will happen? You're going to get a weird Euclidean distance, right? You can't just take Euclidean distance just like that, right? You have to make the distributions more well-behaved, and you're going to have difficulty learning models. So before we start jumping into, hey, push this into this thing, let's look at the distributions, let's deal with this chaos, and all that. So we do a lot of things like transforming the data into different distributions and scaling the data, right? So one of the most interesting things about this is one of the most interesting transformations. So generally, you know, you think of normal distribution as being normal distribution. That means it's normal to have normal distribution, but that's what the textbook says, right? In reality, how many of you have seen a normal distribution in your data? Right? Nobody? Right? So that's the reality. And generally, a lot of distributions are log normal or exponential and things like that. So there are a lot of things we can do to transform these into better features first, right? You can also discover, and these are all on the same Higgs boson data, you can discover interesting things. So this feature, if I take the log, it turns out that it's a bimodal. So understanding your features and their distributions makes you a better data scientist, is the thing. You don't build a model first, you understand your features, and now you can do things differently on your features, right? Now, what about not normal distribution? There are distributions like this, there are distributions which are multimodal. Can there be a universal way to transform all these different types of distribution so you don't have to worry about these kind of variations, right? And my favorite thing to do here is what I call a cumulative density transformation. So if you look at any of the distributions, and you know, this is P of X, X on the X-axis, and P of X on the Y-axis. So if you take X and you actually create a cumulative density function for that, and you can do that for any density function, then you can map this value of X to this number, which is how many points are below me, or what fraction of data is below me, and that's a very universal thing, because you can apply this to any kind of distribution, right? And what that does is it brings all of your features in the same 0 to 1 range, right? And now you can do your Euclidean distances and other things, okay? It works on all kinds of distributions, and you can take a log before you do this, but it won't change anything because, you know, it's a monotonic function. Got it? So it's one of the things that you can try. Now, there's another kind of very common distribution like the Zipf's law. It occurs all the time. This is, if you rank all the words in descending order of frequency, take the log of the rank and the log of the frequency, and it's going to look like a line. So it's a power law. And this occurs in many places. It's not just in words. These are cities in descending order of their population. These are websites with the number of unique visitors. So it's a very common phenomena in a lot of domains. And again, here, log comes to our rescue. So we all know about IDF, and we take a log there. And the reason why we take the log is to tame this exponential thing. And sometimes we also take a log in our TF-IDF, right? When we do TF. So there is a fractal nature. So what is true about the whole corpus is also true about a single document. And therefore, what we do on a single document is also take the log, right? So the point of all this is look at the distributions before you start building the models. Make the, you know, make them homogeneous before you start computing distance functions, right? All right. So the next flash talk is about independence assumption is an unnecessary evil, right? We've been told that, hey, assume independence and your life will be simple. Build an I-based classifier or a vector space model and you'll be done. But really, again, like there is no such thing as a normal distribution. There is also no such thing as a independence assumption, right? So really, one way to look at independence assumption is to say how important is a word in a collection. A collection could be a document or a tag set. So there are two kinds of word weights that we already have, right? We know that IDF weight gives me, you know, the rarer the word, the more important it is. And TF gives me the more frequent the word in a document, this thing. But I believe that these two are actually very useless things. What we really need is what we call a contextual weight. And this is what I mean by a contextual weight. So if I look at these collection of words on the top and the bottom, right? So you have rain, thunder, umbrella, lighting, chocolate, kids, birthday, candies, chocolate, cake, candles. Now if you look at the word chocolate, according to IDF weighting, it's going to get the same weight in both the places, right? But obviously in our mind, we think, oh, the word chocolate doesn't belong here as much as it belongs there, right? So we are giving different weight to the word chocolate based on the context, right? And that is what is missing. And if we can solve that problem, then we have overcome what we call the independence assumption, that you can give weight to a word independent of the other words is a wrong assumption. Let's do it more systematically. So let me give you an example. This is from Flickr. This is an image. And these are the keywords or tags that were given to this image, okay, on Flickr. And if you use the IDF weighting, these are the weighting. And basically it says the rarer the word on the Flickr corpus, the higher the weight, right? Now one problem with that is that each word, let's say the word finger, is going to get exactly the same weight. It doesn't matter where it occurs, right? And that's a big problem, and that's what we need to address. If you want to do anything meaningful with our text data, this is the first problem we need to address, right? So how do we do it, right? So let's look at that question again. How important is a word in the collection? And let me define it in a very simple way, then we'll do the math. So we are saying a word is important if it is strongly connected to other important words in the collection. Simple, right? So you imagine you're part of a team, and you're connected to your manager very nicely, so you are important now. And the third guy who's connected to you is also important because he's connected to another important guy, right? So, and you can imagine this whole thing going on. So let me show you a beautiful use case of the PageRank algorithm on doing this, right? So this is the PageRank equation, and let me break this down. So what I mean is the word is important, okay? So we are saying the word I, XI is the ith word in the collection. Think of the word chocolate. And we are saying, is the word chocolate important or not in the next iteration? So the word is important if it is strongly connected to another word J. So the word J is the other words, right? The word cake or the word candy or the word kids. So XJ is those words. I is the word chocolate. So we are saying if this word is strongly connected to this guy, right? And this word is also important. So if the word cake is important and cake is strongly connected to chocolate, then chocolate will become important, right? And it's a recursive definition, right? And so that's what we can do. And this is where you can put all your independence assumption. So the prior of the page rank, you can say is my TF and IDF. So P0 is proportional to how rare the word is in the corpus and how common the word is in the document. This is what it becomes proportional to. And this is what takes care of the independence assumption, right? So you can mix and match with the theta parameter, and you get a application of page rank or random walk on computing these. So what happens is, and that is the dependence part, right? So if I do that, this is what I get, right? So same words sorted in a different order, because now think of these words as don't look at the picture. So the picture has nothing to do with the tag set, right? The computer is not looking at the picture, right? So we're just looking at these words, and it's saying, oh, the word child, smile, happy, mother, woman, family, this is really what makes the theme of the collection, right? They bubble up automatically because they are strongly connected to each other, and the other words like, you know, Kerala, orange, Hindu, finger, they all go down in the list, right? So you see the transition, right? Another example, here is a set of words on this picture, jumbo, peanut, alligator, bald, and then if I do the contextual weighting, I get these weightings, right? And this is the beginning of all text mining, which is how do you weigh a word in a document, right? And if that is wrong, then everything else you're doing is not really helping, okay? So think of this as one way to think about independence assumption, and not just think about naive Bayes versus something else, think about page rank to do that. All right, so this quote is actually coming from a discussion I had with Alex Smola when we were in Yahoo Research, and we had a long argument, and then I said, hey, you know, it's not really how you count, but how you normalize that matters. Okay, so let me tell you what I mean. So let's look at this example, right? So, and the key message here is model the variance that matters. Okay, so let me tell you what it means. So let's look at an example here. Let's say I want to create an information retrieval system, and I have a feature that says match the title, field could be any field in the document, so match the title to the query, right? And let's say I come up with this simple thing which says, oh, the word, every word in the query, right, has a weight. This could be the IDF weight or whatever weight. And then what is the match of that word or the token in the field, right? What is wrong with this matching function? I mean, it's like, you know, the more words matching the field, the higher the match, right? So it makes perfect sense. But what is the variance that will come into this because of what we are doing? Right. Longer queries might get more weight. Shorter queries might get less weight. So what will happen? The model will have to deal with that variability, which is not really real, right? I mean, when you score, it doesn't matter. You're doing a relative score, but the longer queries will, you know, try to get higher weights. So the model is now working in two spaces, right? One for single word queries and two word queries and three word queries. Why make the life of the model so miserable? So what we can do is just simply do a sum of the weight of the token at the bottom, right? Very simple things like this can make a huge difference in the kind of models that you're going to get. What about the length of the field? Does it matter? Query length matters. Query and field are two parts. What about field length? I'll let you think about that question and use it. Let's look at another domain, credit rating, right? So let's say I'm a bank and I want to decide on your credit rating. I'm looking at your feature, which is how much total card balance do you have, right? So you have taken loans and credit card loans. If I look at this raw feature, what is the problem with the raw feature that I'm looking at, right? So imagine if there are rich people, they'll have a lot of, this number will be high, poor people will have this number low, new graduate students will have very low, right? All kinds of things, right? So there is a variance in that which is not useful to the modeling task. How do I remove that variance? Huh? Yeah, exactly, right? So we do something to say, okay, what is your credit limit and how much of your credit limit you are using? So let's say I have a 5 lakh credit limit and I use 4 lakhs, 3 lakhs all the time, but somebody has, 5,000 credit limit, he also uses 4,000, 3,000, our score should be the same, right? This feature should be the same. So think about whenever you are using absolute numbers, that's the most dangerous thing to do. Always think, is there a variance in this that doesn't affect the model? And how do I remove that variance, right? Total card payment. So if you do card payment regularly, again, it's not about how much card payment, this is an absolute number, right? And absolute numbers are very dangerous things in modeling. You don't want to use them. You want to use normalized. So I'll say, what fraction of card payments out of the balance? Do I pay my balance in full or do I pay my minimum balance? And what fraction of balance do I keep, right? That's a better feature than the thing. Okay, total debt. By itself, total debt is a very dangerous feature because, again, right, rich guys have a lot of debt, poor guys have less debt. they are more happy because of that. But you want to divide it by something like annual income, right? Now you realize, oh, you know what? Total debt is actually exponentially distributed. Annual income is also exponentially distributed, Zipf's law. So maybe a better feature is to take the log of the two. I'm just connecting this to the previous thing and saying, how do you combine multiple such things to come up with better and better features, right? So look at these features, look at the variability when you create a feature like that and see its correlation with the class and see if it is modeling only the variability that matters and not the rest of it, right? Query length doesn't matter, you know, total annual income doesn't matter. So how do we normalize for all that? All right, this is another interesting thing, which is model the deviation from the expected, not the actual thing. So let me give you an example. In forecasting, let's say I want to forecast something. I want to forecast the total sales of, let's say, iPhones in some context. The context could be this place, this time, this segment of population, whatever the context is, right? Again, total sales is an absolute number, which is a very dangerous thing to model because total sales in Mumbai are going to have a completely different distribution than total sales in, let's say, Bhopal or somewhere else, right? So again, it's a very dangerous thing to model an absolute number, and the variability in that is going to be huge. So what we do, instead of modeling the total sale, we say, what is the total sale in this context? And is it higher and lower than the expected sales for that context, right? So on an average, in Mumbai, I sell this many iPhones in the summer. That's my expected. And then what is the actual? And then I take the ratio. So this is a much better feature to use either as a predictor, right? Something you want to predict, or as an input feature, okay? Okay, click prediction, right? So we do a lot of click prediction. So let's say I want to predict what is the CTR going to be for a given query. Query is there for a given URL at a certain position. So for this query, I show this URL at third position, and I want to measure the click-through rate, right? So I can measure that because I can show this result at the third position, and I can see the click-through rate. Now, that itself is again a very dangerous raw attribute to use. So what we can do is we say, okay, in general, what is the CTR we see at the third position? And are we doing better than that or worse than that for this query URL pair? And this is what people use to either bump the page up or down, right? Not the actual CTR values. Okay. All right. So far, everybody is with me? We are doing well? Okay. I think we'll finish this sooner. Yeah. Position. Yeah, so you can normalize it by, let's say, device. So you can say expected position, because let's say cell phones, right, you don't see beyond the fifth position or something versus, let's say, bigger screens, right? So you can have these additional things on top of it. So that's a great question. Whatever we talked about earlier, we can apply to the expected value first based on the context, like device, location, and all that. So you can do all kinds of things. Position is just one of the dimensions in the context. But you can say position, and then country, and then time of day, and then device. What is the expected CTR and all that, and then do the extra, right? So great. All right. So don't take your defaults for granted. And this is very important. I learned that in one of the three search engine companies I worked for. I don't want to tell you which one. It's kind of embarrassing for the company, but you can imagine, right? So this is also an exercise in how do you debug a machine learning model. We all know how to debug a software, right? We know what the behavior is. We write unit tests and they fail. Sometimes we don't, and then we are miserable with the segmentation fault. So there's a life of how do you debug a software program, right? So in software, you will see a different observation. It's not working. The test is failing. In machine learning programs, how do the machine learning programs tell you that there is something wrong? Okay? There's no test for it, right? How do you tell? So what we was noticing is that one of the models were unexpectedly complex, okay? It was way more complex than we wanted it to be. So imagine a decision tree or a gradient-boosted decision tree or something like that, which automatically changes the complexity based on the data. So it was very complex, and we didn't know what's going on, right? We thought, you know, maybe the... And that's where you know that there is some kind of a problem. The model is kind of compensating for some bug. Okay? So, you know, this doesn't happen in software, right? There is no such thing as compensating for a bug. You can have a bad design and a huge code base. You can fix the design of the code base and you can get a better code base size, right? That's what happens in software engineering. In machine learning, you can have complex models which are an indicator. Like if you have an SVM classifier and you have lots of support vectors, something is wrong, right? If you have a decision tree and it's huge, something is wrong, right? If it is unexpectedly big. So here is what the problem was, and I want you to tell me what the problem is, right? So let's say I'm again doing a matching problem. So this is the field, right? Imagine it's a title of a URL. The quick brown fox jumped over a lazy dog, right? All right, so I create one feature, which is term frequency of the query to the field, and I measure that, right? So quick occurs once, brown occurs once, dog occurs once, cat doesn't occur. So I have these features and I can calculate those features, right? Here's another feature called first occurrence, which means the earlier the word occurs, the better, right? So here are the values that I have chosen, right? So quick, the word quick occurs at position 1. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. And, you know, these are the positions, right? And the cat doesn't occur. Now, can anybody tell me what's wrong with this? This whole thing? Cats, what? All. It should be infinity, right? And that's what the problem was, and we had no idea what the hell is going on, right? So everybody got that? The wrong defaults, right? Because we love zero defaults everywhere, right? But without thinking about all the features, if we put all the wrong defaults, something may go wrong, and then the model will try to compensate for that, right? So here, that is the problem. So what is happening is the model is saying, hey, if the query term is present as the first term, it's a great match. Because the number is zero, right? If I add, right? But if the term is absent, again the value is zero, which is equal to the best possible match. And now the model is completely confused about this. It's like telling your children two opposite things and they get confused about what's the right thing to do. And that's what happens. So they go around coming up with very large, you know, reasoning around that, which is not necessary, right? So this is what happened and we figured. So how about a minus one? Would minus one be a good default? I know people love minus one if the values are supposed to be positive, right? First occurrence, zero to infinity. So let's use a default which is not in that range. Would minus one make a great default? No, it's even worse, right? You're actually saying, hey, you're doing well, you're doing even better if the thing is not present, right? Minus one is even better match. So what we did was then we just fixed it. We said field length plus a constant, not infinity, right? And then the model is very nice and cozy, right? So debugging a machine learning model, you know, think about the default values as one of the potential sources of problem. All right. The next thing is, why should models do all the work, right? Poor things, right? And SVM, just throw everything at it and let it run overnight on this 1,000 node Hadoop cluster or whatever and let that figure it out, right? Machines are great, machine learning is great, I'm very hands-off, right, and all that. So these are the two mindsets to machine learning. It's an attitude problem, which is, one is a very model-centric. We love our algorithms, right? I'm an expert in something, you know, it's a, you know, universal approximation engine, whether it's a backpropagation or whatever, so therefore I can throw whatever at it and it should be able to figure it out, right? So that is one mindset to modeling. And what we do there is we create very basic, simple features, like we talked about, right? The absolute values without normalizing, without taking care of the distributions. Without doing all that, we put this, and the model has to go through hell, right? The other mindset is what I call a feature-centric mindset, which is you spend a lot of time on each feature, right? You see how to normalize, you see if you need a log, you see all these things, and then you come up with a complex feature, and then it'll lead to a simple model, right? Now people say, oh, you know what, my model is logistic regression, and others will laugh at you and say, oh, you're just using a very basic modeling technique, right? But that's not the thing. You're actually working a lot on your feature side. So each feature is by itself a very great model in itself. Think of each feature as a model in itself. It's modeling one aspect of the problem, and logistic regression is just combining all the aspects into a final score. Okay, so that kind of mindset is what makes a great data scientist. So here's a very simple example. You must have seen it in textbooks. So if I have these two class problem and the data is like this, right? So if I say, hey, I don't care about feature engineering, I just want my model to learn everything, this is what I'm going to learn, right? I'm going to say neural networks, I'm going to need so many hyperplanes to figure this out, right? But if I was cute about, if I was like, you know, looking at the data and figured out, oh, this is the structure in the data, let me create a new feature, right, which is x1 minus a, so this is a constant we learn, and then I create an equation of a circle, suddenly I've transformed this data into very nice two parts, and my model is very simple now, right? So there is no shame in using a simple modeling technique as long as you are doing a great job of feature engineering. So let's look at a real example, a simplified version. So credit card fraud detection. Now let's say I give you these four raw inputs, right? So what is the time and place of your previous credit card transaction? What is the time and place of your current credit card transaction? And I want to know whether the current credit card transaction is a fraud or not, right? Now how do we do this? So if I throw these four numbers, four features into the model, right? I am a model-centric data scientist. I don't care about features. If I throw these four things, will it ever learn anything useful? Because time can be anything, place can be anything, right, all that stuff. What can we do with these four features to do feature engineering to create a better feature? Pardon? Right. Distance and time, right? So if you look at a distance and time, distance and thing, and then can I do even better? Usual time transaction periods. But usual time transactions could be, right. And you know, if a shopaholic is shopping, the time is very small and the distance is not at all anything, right? So obviously there are a lot of things there. But I can actually measure a velocity, if you will, right? Velocity of transaction. And now I know that velocity cannot be a very high number. So what I've done is I've taken four raw features, and I have a good data scientist who thinks about feature engineering, and I say, based on the domain knowledge, I know that two transactions cannot happen in Eastern Europe and South Africa in a very short amount of time, and therefore, so velocity, now think of velocity as a monotonic function, which is very highly correlated with fraud rate. All right? So these are the kinds of things that will make a better model. The neural network doesn't know anything about your domain knowledge. It doesn't know velocity, it doesn't know human nature, it doesn't know anything. You know all that, so we better use that, right? So same thing in text, right? I mean, you can use unigrams all day long, right? And you're going to get some level of achievement in your classification model. So I can use words like Nations, Security Council, U dot, N dot. So these are my unigrams. Or I can go and improve the quality of my features, right? So I can do bigrams and trigrams, but the problem is nation security will become a bigram, and a blind bigram is more dangerous than a unigram, right? So think about that. Don't just say, oh, I have a Python bigram detector, and you know it runs on Hadoop and lets me just get all that, right? So don't think like that. Start thinking whether bigrams is what you want. But actually what you want, more than bigrams and trigrams, are real phrases. Can I detect phrases? Can I match my text to Wikipedia or have another way to detect real phrases and then build models on top of it? Can we do even better than this? So now you've gone from unigrams to phrases, right? And you're not thinking of bag of words, but bag of words slash phrases. Can we do better than this? Huh? Synonyms, right? Exactly. So between synonym and that, there is one more stage, that is a disambiguated phrase, right? If I see the thing UNSC, is it the same thing as United Nations Security Council, or is it some other abbreviation? I could match this to that, but it'll be a problem. And then we also do the concept. So the idea is, how do you grow a feature capability from a very simple unigrams all the way to disambiguated phrases and their concepts? And, you know, the same thing in text, in images, you can think about, you know, these as features from face data that we have created, which are higher level feature than small SIFT features, right? And you've created higher level features, the same thing in another data, and using these higher level features, we do a better job. So the idea of feature engineering is a very profound idea. That's what is, I think, the most time that we should spend on, which is how do you create these higher level, more meaningful features and not worry about why my SVM is, you know, taking so much time to learn, right? This is where the meat is, okay? So let's talk about one more thing, which is it's not what you say, but what you mean that matters, right? I'm not talking about life and personal communication. I'm talking about data mining, okay? Sorry. So let's go back to that question again. What makes us intelligent? So let me show you a picture. You must have seen this before. Tell me, what do you see? Wow. You see dogs all the time? Is that what you see when you don't see anything? Right? How many people see a dog? Was that easy to see? I mean, if you've seen this before, it's easy. But see, most of the people are not able to see the dog yet. Right? Now tell me, if you were actually seeing the dog, what is going on in your brain? Dog is eating something, right? There's a tree behind it and all that. But, you know, if you give this picture to like a 5-year-old, 7-year-old, they'll take more time to figure this out, right? All. This is also something that makes us intelligent, which is the semantics. When I say semantics, I mean semantics of the parts and the semantics of the whole. What is the semantics of the picture depends on the semantics of the parts of the picture. And the parts of the picture have no semantics. See this blob here, right? Or this little thing here is actually the ear of the dog, but by itself it has no meaning. If I just look at it that way, but if I look at it in conjunction with the rest of the picture, I start to assign meaning to this part, right? But the context itself has no meaning yet. Each of the parts is still no meaning. So it's again a recursive problem. Like I said, right? A word is important if it is connected to other important words. These recursive definitions are all over the place in machine learning. So this is again, you know, the meaning of this part depends on the meaning of the other parts, which we don't know yet. So now we are doing this kind of thing. Oh, this must be this, therefore this is that. So the whole picture will suddenly make sense, right? In a moment of flash, you will start to see a dog. Because your brain is churning through this kind of thing, assigning meaning to all the parts and saying, no, this doesn't fit. I don't think that's what it means, right? So understanding meaning is a very important thing that intelligent things do. So, but, you know, indexing systems are, you know, very dumb, right? No matter how big in scale they get, they're still very dumb. They're doing keyword matching. They don't understand. So if I put the word program, I can get results like computer program, NASA program, radio program, you know, America's program, learning program. So the word program has so many meanings, right? The word rock has so many meanings. The movie, the this and that. So, and you know, the dumb search engines, sorry, I'm from Google and I'm calling them dumb search engines, but that's where they are, right? They are dumb search engines who don't understand, and therefore they'll just give you a 10 blue link list, and then we need to do something about it. So semantics is very important, and, you know, that's what we need to do when we need to work on text data. So we saw an example of phrasing, right? Phrases are important. If I match these two sentences and the word time occurs here and here, the word new occurs here and here, I'm going to say, oh, that's a great match, but you have to first phrasify before you can match, right? Same thing here. If I say I was right to avoid a suit against Apple, or you know, a man in red suit on my right was drinking apple juice, you cannot say that these are very similar sentences. A machine which doesn't understand meaning will say that, but humans will not say that, right? So we are not in the keyword matching, you know, we are in the 21st century. We're not in the last century. Therefore, we should be able to understand text before we do anything on top of it, right? And then again, you know, find a suit charging orange. Now we know that orange is also a company, not a fruit, right? Apples don't sue oranges, but actually I'll show you an example where they do. So, right, so let's look at this from a parsing point of view, right? So there are two big communities in text understanding. One is NLP community. They love their parsers. That's what they go by. This is a Stanford parser on this sentence. The sentence is New York Times reported construction of a new international airport in New York City, right? So the word new occurs in three places, and I give it to this nice Stanford parser that everybody in the world uses, and it starts with the word reports because that's the verb, and it builds the whole parse tree, and let's look at what happens. Look at this word new here. This word new is treated as an adjective, right? How is my brain interpreting that? It's not a single word. It is actually a whole phrase. Therefore, please don't separate that word and give it a meaning. Please do phrasing before you start doing parsing, right? And if I do that, then it says, okay, now I can believe this parse. And then you have new as an adjective here is fine, right? But not this new as an adjective. You understand? So we talked about phrases as a building block, starting point. Even before you do parsing, you should start thinking about proper phrase embedding before you do parsing, right? All that. And then semantics, right? Now tell me, what is this word? Spelling correction. Important, right? Now, same word. Easier to? It was easier, right? Now, let's read this, right? I know you can read. You can just read. Yeah. Got it? So it's self-explanatory that although the spellings are not correct, because of the context, you're able to find the meaning of these words. So that's a very important philosophical statement, that the meaning of the word is in the context of the thing. Okay? So let's look at the disambiguation problem. What is it that we really want to do? There are two parts in disambiguation. One is take a raw word, the lemma, the thing that appears, and first discover how many meanings are there for that word in the corpus. And it has nothing to do with the dictionary. And that's the worst part about text mining, that we can rely on WordNet or, thesaurus or this and that, when the real world data is very, very different, right? I mean, there are far more meanings of a pronoun. Tweets has its own language, right? Look at the hashtags, what they mean. So the notion of word sense has nothing to do with, let me look up all the meanings in the dictionary or a WordNet or something, right? So it has to be discovered. And in the pharma world, let's say in the medicine domain, the word pain could mean more of something than the other. But if you are talking about philosophy, the word pain could mean something else, right? So that's the first part, which is how many meanings does a word have? And second part is, given the context, let me first assign the right meaning and then do anything going forward. Understand? So we are not doing things at this level, we are doing things at this level. This is what I call a semantic tokenization of the corpus. Okay? So what we have done phrasing properly, and then we have done disambiguation, two stages. And now I can say apple 1 as in fruit is equal to orange 3 as in fruit. But if I say apple is equal to orange, again, I'm relying on the system, the LDA or whatever, to figure that out, that apple actually has through so many meanings and orange has so many meanings. And now one meaning of this is equal to one meaning of that, and the mess of doing equivalencing, puts the modeling technique. That's why LDA doesn't take long time, because it's LDA. It takes long time because we don't do disambiguation before we do LDA. Okay? So think about these stages now. Phrasing, disambiguation, then LDA or whatever your favorite synonymy thing is, right? There's another interesting problem. This is related to the dog picture, and I want to show the connect, right? So if I look at these sentence, right? Orange, filed, suit, apple. These are all ambiguous words. Like in the dog picture, all the parts of the picture were ambiguous, right? You're not solving one ambiguous problem of one word given the context. What you're solving is a joint ambiguous problem, which is, given that this word can have so many meanings, which meaning of this goes with which meaning of this goes with which meaning of this goes with which meaning of that. So it's a joint disambiguation problem. It's not a one-off problem like rock as in, like I showed before, right? So these are the kinds of joint problems we always solve. It's very similar to the contextual weighting thing, right? The weight of this depends on the weight of that. So if I assign a different meaning to the word orange here, the meaning of the word filed could mean something else, right? If this was a fruit, the word file could mean filing the peel of the orange, if that was the meaning of that word, right? So the meaning is not a very obvious thing. And that is what makes us intelligent, that we do a joint inferencing over the disambiguation space. All right. Have you heard of that too many cooks spoil the broth? I just borrowed that. Too many classes spoil the classifier, right? Have you seen that before? I mean, most of us work on a binary classification problem, right? Spam, not spam, fraud, not fraud, credit, give or not, but a lot of problems have many, many classes. So what happens is, when you build a complex model and you say, okay, let's say this is 20 classes, right? Let's say this is a neural network, you're building 20 classes, and now you have a number of hidden units here. The problem is this, that these hidden units are forced to learn the boundaries across all the classes simultaneously. Now imagine the pain of the neural network, right? We are like sitting there with, you know, with our SS drives and Hadoops, and the poor thing has to figure out how to distinguish between 20 classes simultaneously and come up with the right hyperplanes, right? So instead of doing that, one of the things we could do, so I'll just show you an example of on this data and then on another data. What about a hierarchy of classes? So two classes, not all classes are equally difficult to distinguish, but we know how to do a two-class problem very, very well, right? So we know that, so why don't we use that to our advantage and let's solve the pairwise, think of agglomerative clustering of classes. So what will happen? Let's build a classifier between all pairs of classes and look at the, let's say, validation accuracy, and that tells me that this class has the lowest validation accuracy, which means this is very hard to distinguish and they are very similar to each other. So now, at least I can distinguish with some classifier these two classes, however good the quality is, and now I can combine them into a meta class, right? The next pair that I found was 1 versus 7, 3 versus 8, and you can see why these are difficult classes, right? So we build these bottom-up agglomerative tree of classes, pairs of classes, and then we keep doing the agglomeration on top, right? So what is happening here is, each of this is a two-class problem, and we know how to solve two-class problems. And here we have 6 versus samples from both 1 and 7, right? So are coming here, and we solve a two-class problem. What are the benefits? So if I look at a one class versus the other, my feature space is going to be very small, right? So imagine if I ask you to just distinguish 4 and 9 and say which features will be useful just for 4 versus 9, it's a very simple set of features, right? If I ask you to distinguish all the 10 classes simultaneously, it's a very complex feature space you're looking for. But if I simplify the problem 1 versus 7, all you're looking for is this top bar or something, right? And that's a simple. So you simplify the feature space, you simplify each of the pairwise classifiers, you actually can interpret what's going on. So these are very simple, you know, three features out of 128 features, you know, whatever the 28 times 28 could actually distinguish between. These are two ways of writing, let's say 7, right? Some people like it with a cross, without a cross. So you can discover these hidden structures also, but you can, because you're only focusing on two classes at a time, you can do a lot better, right? Here is something on the letters data set. Digits is 10 classes, this is 26 classes, we get this. Lots of advantages, right? You can only do localized features, I versus J. I don't need to build a very complex classifier for I versus J, things like that, right? Simpler models. You can interpret the features very nicely, your accuracy goes up, and you can model all these in parallel, right? So you have C choose two classifiers, we know how to do parallel, so we do parallel, right? So these can be done in parallel, and you don't have to load the whole data in memory and all that, just the data you need and all that, right? So think about whenever you're dealing with lots of classes, try to break down the problem in the class space. Okay. That is automatically discovered. That's an additional advantage, which is, you know, imagine agglomerative clustering. Instead of clustering data points, you're clustering classes. And you define a distance between two classes by the validation accuracy of the pairwise classifier. So now you say merge this first because this has the lowest accuracy and then, you know, keep doing your thing. No. You rediscover the features for each pairwise classifier. Right. But you update the matrix by when you added a meta class, now you build the classifier of this versus the n minus 1 and keep doing the same thing as agglomerative clustering, but and every time you learn a new set of features. You don't depend on the previous because now 1 versus 7 had this thing, but with 6 it'd be a completely different ballgame, right? So you have a choice to do that. Right, it'll be very small compared to the traditional. If you try to distinguish all the letters simultaneously, right, see, the complexity depends on the manifold of the you know, distinguishing boundary, right? The boundary between classes. What we have done is we have focused on two classes at a time. So we have, you know, simplified the manifold that we want to learn. And then, you know, we learn multiple such things and then we combine them at the next stage. So I think that's how we also do things. So let's say I want to distinguish between, you know, chairs versus tables at some level of hierarchy and furnitures versus cars at some level of hierarchy, right? So our brain also learns this hierarchy in the same way. You know, it says these are all furnitures, some meta class here, these are all cars, but then within cars you have used cars, new cars, whatever, and here you have multiple classes, right? So our brain also learns hierarchies of objects in the same way. So here when you think of an object, you can think of a class or a meta class. You know, all characters with a circle kind of thing, right? C, B, one class, right? All letters with vertical lines, horizontal lines. So we imagine, you know, doing these kind of hierarchies building automatically. Right? And I don't think we learn a neural network the traditional way, right? Solve the whole thing. Okay, class labels are very precious, but take them with a pinch of salt. So I'm going to tell you that even to generate your thing that you want to predict needs an art. It's also an art. It's not always given. So let's look at an example. Credit card fraud. So, you know, you do millions of transactions and most of them are normal, right? So you don't call the bank and the bank assume that that transaction is fine, right? So there's a lot of positive or negative data, which is non-fraud, right? But then, let's say you lost your card or somebody stole your card, you immediately call the bank and the next transaction that happens on the card, bank knows that that is fraud and it puts a label there, right? So we collect label like that. But what can happen is you may not know that, you know, somebody else is using your card. You see the bill after a month and then you say, oh, I didn't do these transactions, and then you get labels later, right? So how we get labels is also a domain-specific thing and it can happen in so many ways. Now, let's say you didn't look at your credit card transaction and you missed some of the fraudulent transactions, so you didn't even report all the frauds that happened, right? So label data is not like a holy grail that is written in stone. It can have all its own problems, right? So if you try to beat the data into submission and say, no, you must fit this class labels, you know, you are probably learning noise in the label data, okay? Let's look at another example, credit risk. So here, you want to predict this. Will the customer default? This is a different default than the previous default. Disambiguation. So I'm just trying to connect all these pieces. Okay. Right? So default in the next 6 months. So that's what you want to predict. Now, how do you create label data for that? Right? You can't sit today and say, okay, I'm going to wait for 6 months and figure out something. So what you do, you look at historical data. So this is where you are now, right? And you know that this guy has defaulted or not defaulted, okay? And what you do is you look at T minus 180 days back in time and you treat this as the observed data. Although you are here, you could actually observe this data also. But this futuristic prediction demands that you don't look at the future data, right? So you don't look at this data. You only look at this data as your input and you try to predict whether it defaulted here and you treat this as unobserved data. So again, this is an art to how to create label data out of existing database that you have, right? So depending on how you define your problem, you can actually create data in a temporal order in that sense, okay? All right, let's look at retrieval, right? So we said that, hey, as soon as you click on a result, we get a feedback from the user. But there is a lot of noise there, right? So sometimes you might click accidentally, right? Your daughter is playing with your iPhone, you did a search and she clicked on something and, you know, Google says, oh, there's a click down, right? But it's an accidental click. How do we distinguish an accidental click, right? There might be spam clicks, right? I mean, I don't know if you've seen that case study where Google was trying to see if Bing is copying some of the results. And then what happened was we did a lot of spam clicks on Bing and Bing thought that this was actually real and they started building models on that, right? Just to see whether that philosophy was correct. So sometimes, you know, one search engine can try to screw the other search engine, right? Using small, right? Now let's look at short clicks, right? You go to a click, you read the snippet, you look at the, you do the click, and as soon as you go there, you find that, oh, this is actually a spam page and that's what not you want. Immediately you come back. So how long did you spend on that page tells you a lot about whether it's a spam, short click or a long click. And then there is a position bias, right? Did you click on the third link? and not the first two. What does that tell me? That first two are not relevant to you, third is relevant to you. So not click is also a signal, right? So the art of collecting labeled data, depending on the domain, is also very interesting. Ad clicks, again, there are a lot of spam clicks, right? I mean, if you are retailer one and retailer two, and one guy wants to, you know, finish off your, you know, budget on shoes, like Adidas and whatever, and then what they can do is this guy can hire a bunch of students and just click on those ads of the other guy, and he runs out of money, and nobody, you know, and then you can sell your stuff, right? So there's a lot of that happens. This is actually a real fraud. I mean, we were shocked to hear that, oh, whatever we do, there is a fraud, right? Credit card, there is a fraud. You know, ads, there is a fraud. You know, email, there is a spam. You know, web pages, there is spam. I mean, I don't know. I mean, human nature is just weird, right? It's just making our lives harder and harder every day, right? What about accidental clicks or curiosity clicks, right? Why is this ad there? You wonder. Right? You say, oh, yeah, that ad is there because of this. And then you say, oh, yeah, that's great. Let me come back. Right? So that's a, you know, that's what we call a curiosity click, right? And then how do you say whether a click is important or conversion? How do you define conversion, right? Did he actually click and then bought something, or he just clicked and then left or something, right? So how do you define what is a feedback, what is a class label in this class, okay? All right, so labels are very precious, right? If you talk to people in genomics and cancer research, for example, you know, to collect one cancer patient who died of cancer, somebody has to die of cancer to collect a positive label, right? Sorry, but that's how it is. And that's why it's important to cure the world of cancer, right? But we need that to get this. It's not like doctors are waiting, when I need one more sample, I need one more sample, right? It's not like that, but it's a costly thing, right? You know, astronomy, right? If you're looking at a star in a certain direction, it takes a whole year to Earth for to get back there. If you can't make your observation on that precise day, you know, you have to wait for one more year, and astronomy PhDs probably take 10 years than usually, right? Probably because of this reason. For them, the label data is far more costly, right? Obviously, there are other issues. Cost is there. Noise is there. We talked about the noise. So how do we, you know, unlabeled data is very cheap, right? Satellites are going around all the time collecting a lot of unlabeled data on the Earth. But people who have to go to these weird places and collect the sample, oh, this is like a marsh, or this is a sand, or this is a wheat, you know, they have to suffer through the collection process, right? Satellites are very nicely collecting input data. So we have lots of input data, but very little label data, right? So how do we do things with that? So there is a whole research in semi-supervised and active learning. So here is an example of a semi-supervised learning where we said, okay, these are two news groups from the news group data, right? These are two very simple news groups to distinguish. I'm talking about pairwise classifiers again. Think of, you know, there are 20 news groups. I'm picking one news group pair, which is very easy to distinguish. And we label only 5 examples. And we build a classifier, right? We get some accuracy. Then we use that, label all the remaining 1,000 examples, pick a few, call them labeled, and then we build another classifier, and then the accuracy goes up, right? So you can, it is okay to have very few labeled data if you know how to, you know, bring in the unlabeled data into the mix and keep improving your classifiers, right? So we get 100% because these are very simple classes. And computer OS versus graphics, we start with 10 labels and we get to 99. With just 10 labels, 5 of this class, 5 of this class, and we can still build a classifier, right? So don't worry if your cost is very high, you can use other techniques to compensate for that. Active learning, I'll just show you a picture. So let's say initially I only have these 6 samples as 2 classes, right? The circle class and the square class. And if that is the case, I'm going to build a classifier like that, right? So it's very simple. Now, I use that classifier to score the rest of the labeled data. So these are the other data points that were there, but I didn't have labels for them. But I can now score them. So I have scored according to this model, but you know, this is the actual labels. So obviously, this model was not able to capture the correct decision boundary, right? But it captured something. So now I want to know, the question is, hey, my labeling cost is very high, right? So which points that are not labeled should I get labels for? And that's what active learning does. So we say generally that, you know, points that are near the decision boundary, the current decision boundary, are the ones that you should go and take these data points, go to a human expert who can label them for you, right? There is no point labeling these guys, right? There are already, the confidence of the model is very high. So what we do, we build a model with whatever data we have, we apply the model to all the data, then we look at the confidence or how close the data points, the unlabeled data points are to the decision boundary, and we sample in proportion to that. Now there's one more mix in this, which is, let's say I have already labeled, let's say I've already got a label for this guy. There is no need to get a label for this guy, right? Remember, we are trying to be efficient about the labeling process, right? So redundancy, if I have a label of a nearby data point, don't get another label. If I'm very confident about a data point, according to the previous classifier, don't get a new label. If I'm here, then only get a label. Also, density, right? I mean, if this guy is kind of an outlier and it doesn't fit in the mix anywhere, there is, although it matches all the other criteria, right? It is kind of close to the boundary, right? It is not close to any other labeled data point, but still it is far from the cloud, and you're not going to get a good confidence in the model in this space anyway. So why get a label on that? Because it's a costly thing, right? So how do you optimize your labeling process should depend on all these things, right? Confidence, this is confidence twice, but yeah, I think this, yeah. Okay, got it? So active learning is another interesting area. Okay, so this is the last flash talk, which is, there is more to a decision than a prediction. So remember, we went through that cycle of, you know, feature engineering and this and that. At the end, we make a decision from a prediction. Prediction is what the score comes out, right? A score is high, a probability of default, that's a score. What is the decision? The decision could be increase the credit limit, decrease the credit limit, right? Cancel the account, right? Send him a letter. These are decisions, right? So decisions based on prediction. Ultimately, we want to cross that last mile. So let's look at this example. I wanted to show you, this is also part of my vision talk, visualization talk. So here we have collection notes from a bank, which is a bank is saying, hey, you didn't pay your bills for the last credit card statement, and you know, you get these annoying calls, right? Sometimes in the middle of a presentation, you get these calls, and you know, these guys talk to you, and this you come up with an excuse, right? I forgot, or I don't have enough money, I'm going through divorce. So what we did was, I'm not going through divorce, right? Yeah, just kidding. Right? So people come up with very nice excuses, right? I mean, the dog ate my bill or something would be a nice thing. So collection notes, so it's a very dirty data because some uninterested guy who doesn't really care is typing what the hell you are saying and he knows you are lying. So there's a lot of data noise and all that, right? He's using his own slang and, you know, probably putting some curse words from his side, right? So there's a lot of that in the data, but it still has some structure. So we learn the structure and we say, oh, these are the concepts in this thing. So I can read it for you. Bankruptcy, you know, not sufficient fund, forgot out of town, you know, waiting for funds, accounting mix-up problems. So there are like, all these are concepts that we discover, right? And then we also have a model on the side, which has not used the text data at all, but the data point has text, the data point has other features. Using the other features, we have built a scoring model, which says, will he actually pay or not, right? No matter how many times you call him, he'll just not pay, right? So there's no point keep calling him, wasting your time. Give it to some other agency and they'll take care of it, right? Sorry. Yeah, sometimes they do that, right? So you have to take decisions on that. So here is the difference between a score, which is a one-dimensional set of numbers, and a decision. So if I look at this visual, what I see is that there are hotspots in different places, right? So this is the hotspot because you're unable to reach. So definitely the guy is not picking up your phone, he's not going to pay, right? This is a hotspot for a different reason, bankruptcy and all that. So this is a different thing, he's not going to pay for a different reason, right? This guy has payment disputes. He's saying this is not the right thing, I have payment disputes, so he's not paying for a different reason. Maybe you can resolve this guy through talking and bribing and all that, but that is a different thing, right? This guy is not paying because he has not sufficient funds. So the story is, scores only tell you a probability. They don't tell you the reason, unless you generate reason codes, right? So sometimes your model should also generate the reason why it is giving a high or a low thing. But here, based on the talking and putting these two pictures together, We can actually say, oh, there are 5-6 groups of people who are not paying, so let me take different decisions on different groups of people. Let's not just say, score above this, make a phone call. Score above this, send a policeman. Score above this, right, you know, just whatever else, right? So you don't do a linear thing, you understand the reason, okay? And by the way, this is not what I meant by the art of data mining. Although it's a pretty picture, but that's not what I mean. All right. So prediction score is not everything. You have to understand the reason behind things, and then so that the step from prediction to decision has to go through that extra business constraint, understanding why the score is high, and then appropriately taking the decision. Right? So in the same thing, if I say sending reaffirm to attorney, mailing reaffirm to attorney, court case still pending. So if I put that query, it fits right here. So, you know, this is kind of a, both a visualization of the text data. You are able to visualize the concepts, the model, as well as a query on top of it, right? This is another guy, she thought she was caught up already, she transferred the money, checking on Monday, so she's going to pay, and it falls right here in a blue region, right? So just from the text, you can actually see what they're saying, and therefore whether they'll pay or not, right? It's a very live thing you can do. All right, so let's do the last example, which is on recommendation, right? We love recommendation engines. Some of us hate them, right? I get the wrong movie all the time, right? Okay, so this was a recommendation engine problem. So let's say the guy bought two products, right? Car deck and car mini disc. So this is like a very old car. And this is what we recommended, right? So normally when we do recommendation engines, we are very tempted to recommend the first thing, right? Oh, this has got a high recommendation score, let's send that, right? That's an obvious thing to do. So prediction directly translates into decision, right? But now let's see what we can do on top of it. So let's say I look at these products and the graph among them. So this is a graph that says if he buys this, he will also buy that, right? So that kind of graph. Now, let's say this black thing is what you already have. The red thing, this one is the most highly ranked product. Now, if I recommend this product, what will happen? He's going to buy this, maybe, right? And he'll go away and, you know, you're happy, he's happy. But if I recommend this guy, a lower ranked product, but in the middle of many other products, then what will happen? If he buys this guy with a lower probability, the chances are that he'll end up buying more of this stuff. So the overall utility might be higher, although the conversion rate might be lower. Right? It's the bidding model that we just saw. Probability of click might be lower, but the utility that, you know, I might get him to buy all this other stuff is higher. So, again, recommendation score, just don't go and jump and say, you know, these are the top five products. Try to create a utility function on top of recommendation score, which says what is the overall utility to me, right? Whether I want to maximize loyalty, whether I want to maximize cross-sell, what is the overall utility and how does this joint second order recommendation help me in making a decision? Okay, all right, so that's all. I'll just summarize. So we understand and tame the data nuances, the distributions and all that. We preserve the variances that matter, query length versus not. Don't think of model as a modeling exercise. Think of it as a feature engineering plus a modeling exercise, right? Don't beat the data into submission as in, you know, I need to get 90% accuracy no matter what. Maybe your labels are wrong. Maybe your defaults are wrong, right? There could be reasons for that. And generating class labels has to be done very thoughtfully and creatively. And decisions are more than just prediction. You have a score, you have a cause, and you have a business objective, and then you come up with a decision. Okay? All right, so I'll just stop there with this code. Why are we all here? It's a closing talk, so I need to have a nice code. So Ray Kurzweil, I don't know how many of you know it, but look him up. So he says, our technology, our machines, is part of our humanity. Dogs have not created Hadoop and birds have not created planes. Humans have. And we have done this because we want to extend ourselves, right? We can't hold so much data in the brain, so we create a database system. We can't see far into the space, so we create telescope. We can't, you know, see things in the microscopic level, so we create that. So we are really extending ourselves and our relationship with the world. And that is very human. So we create them to extend ourselves, and that is what is unique about human beings. So Whenever you feel like you're doing something cold and fuzzy and non-human, just go back to this and say, no, we are doing something, we are extending ourselves. And, you know, hopefully that will give you some peace. Okay, questions?
Hi, here.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Man.
So,
okay. There? Yeah.
I am Sunil, and my question is related to the segment where you said we need to model the deviation from the expected,
yes.
Right? But in both the examples that you gave, there are two things, right? One is the actual thing that we are trying to model, and there is an expected, like the total sales and expected sales thing, right?
Right.
So the expected is basically a dummy kind of model or an obvious thing, like
if you didn't have a model, what would you say?
Right. So
the sale of candle will go up in Christmas time. You're not adding any value. It's a seasonal thing. The expected thing is already high. So what is the big deal? Yeah.
Right. So given that we know, the fact that we are able to expect something, that means that we know the attribute that affects the right-hand side, that we know that this is what is going to happen.
Right.
So why not add that attribute in the modeling set of attributes itself instead of modeling the deviation?
Sure. The problem is this. If you are building a linear classifier, it doesn't know how to take ratios. Right?
Right.
So you have said, you know, total sales, expected sales are two features going into a linear model.
Right.
So it cannot do that. So what happens is, that is why you have to compensate for the inability of the model through feature engineering. So you could probably take log of this,
yes,
log of that, and
exactly,
linear,
sir,
and the ratio will come up. Yeah. So that's the mindset, right? You can be creative this way or that way.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Yes. But what about velocity, right? It's a more complicated thing. So sometimes it can be beyond the scope of the model, right?
Hi, sir.
Okay, we have some time for a couple more questions, and then everybody make sure that you stick around for after this. We're going to have an awesome panel discussion, star-studded panel. Make sure that you stay, and afterwards and during, we are going to be giving out tons of free goodies. If you take a look over there, we have everything from plenty of sponsors. Make sure that you stick around. You do not want to miss this. Thank you very much. Let's get back to the questions.
Hi, sir. My question is, in contextual weighting, so how do we define the context? Is it a sentence or paragraph or document or the collection?
It depends on the data. If it's a tweet is the concept.
Okay.
If it's a YouTube video, you could say all the videos watched by the same person in the same session.
Okay.
Or you can say all the videos watched by the same person in the last 3 months.
Okay.
So context is again the art. How do you pick the context is up to you. And you will see that there's more noise, less noise, more signal, depending on how coarse or fine-grained the context is.
Sir, here.
Yes. Yes.
In that Flickr example that you gave,
right,
the page rank kind of weighting, was the other important term tagged for the same image or the importance of this other term across the collection?
No, no. Within this, it's a contextual. It's not a global thing. Right? So the word, let's say I bring a motorcycle in the room, the importance will be low, right? You will say, oh, what the hell, and, you know, make some noise around that. But if I bring in, another microphone, so the context is important. If I take the motorcycle in the parking lot, that's where it belongs. The chair doesn't belong there. So it's always about within the context, what is the weight? And that's why it has to be done for each data point. You have to run the page rank on that data point with just a small graph on it. Not a global page rank on the whole thing. That's the difference.
Shailesh, to your left.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I really enjoyed your talk.
Sure.
Regarding active learning, is there a way to do it without the human in the loop? Can you touch upon active learning and provide some alternative ways of getting this, getting the ground truth and labels?
Yeah, so that's a good point. If we don't need a human in the loop, we don't need machine learning. Think about that. Huh? Yeah, we don't need, all kinds of labeled data has a human, whether you are clicking on a search result through crowdsourcing, whether an expert is saying cancer versus not, whether it's a lawyer in the legally discovery work. So everywhere there's a human label, and if not human, there is another complex process, right? Like if you take your DNA and put it through the machine, there is a cost to doing that also, right? So don't think of human versus not, think of the cost. And you know, sometimes human cost could be low, right? Mechanical Turk, crowdsourcing. Sometimes human cost can be high. Think of the cost. And and think about this. If you don't need a human, do you need a machine learning?
Shailesh?
Yeah.
Yeah. So thanks for your talk. Really enjoyed it. I don't have a background in data science, so I hope this doesn't sound really nice.
No problem.
So I was just thinking, how far is it possible for statistical solutions to semantic questions go? What happens when you're dealing with complex languages, say the law? How is the Google Scholar search engine different from a normal Google search engine? Is it possible for a machine to understand a joke? It's not possible for all of these answers to be purely generated by statistics, right? So how would you approach this?
Yeah, so that's where we need to go beyond statistics, right? So like we did parsing, think of parsing as an NLP algorithm. But, you know, my belief is that unless you put multiple such building blocks together, by itself, one building block is not going to cut it. So if you are, you know, you have to be sort of a breadth person also to see that you need five different building blocks, and maybe your company has a separate team for phrasing, separate team for disambiguation, and they're not talking to each other. But you need to put all that to get real value out of your data, right? So yes, I think data goes through a sequence of embellishments, right? Improvements in its quality, in its semantics and all that. And you have to recognize what order, what are the things that you need to do to make that better and better over time. But sticking with one technique, saying this is my favorite, this will do everything, is the wrong attitude. So, and recognizing that you need, you know, all kinds of things is very important. And how do you, so the next wave of machine learning is not about improving SVM, it's about, you know, using SVM with agglomerative clustering like in the hierarchy. That is the new kind of innovation that will happen in machine learning.
Shailesh, to your left.
Okay.
Way to your left. I'm sitting at the monitor.
Okay.
My question is about the feature engineering. You showed an example where, this was in the default section where you're putting zero as a default. There was one feature where you indicated the presence or absence of a keyword in that in the phrase, and there was a separate feature for the position.
Right.
Isn't the first feature sort of redundant in this case? I mean, because the second feature also also.
Good question.
Is there a
right? So if the model is looking at them very independently, right? If they are part of different branches in the decision tree, then it's a big problem. But if these two features are part of the same branch in the same path in the decision tree, then it will figure it out. So interaction between variables is a very important part beyond feature engineering. You've created features, but what about interactions among them? That's what the model is supposed to learn. And if your model is able to learn that interaction and say, whenever this is zero, ignore this, whenever this is non-zero, then use this. If it's able to learn, that's great. But you know, you don't want to take that chance.
Adding that will increase your, increase your outcome.
I mean, letting model do most of the work is like deploying child labor, you know? I mean, the poor model is not really a grown-up person yet, right? I mean, it's still growing up, it doesn't know many things. So you give him little tasks that it can chew.
Hi, okay? Here.
Yeah.
Left, okay, left. Unfortunately, yeah. That is all the time for questions that we have today. I know that you guys have many, many more, but we have to continue on with the next panel discussion. So everybody give a huge round of applause. This is fantastic. Thank you.